It's Professor Dave. Let's talk about different types of protons.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So in chemistry, and in particular in the context of NMR spectroscopy, we will often hear these terms homotopic, enantiotopic, diastereotopic, and heterotopic. And we want to understand what they mean. So first, let's just go over the definitions of these terms. So let's start first with homotopic. What we're going to do is, let's say we have this molecule of ethane. And if we take two protons, let's say we're examining these two protons here, and we want to understand the relationship between those two protons, what we can do is we can draw two new molecules. And in each one, we'll replace one of those two protons with some other element, let's say chlorine, arbitrarily. And so for one of them, we'll take the hydrogen on the wedge, and we'll turn it into a chlorine. And for the other molecule, we'll take the hydrogen on the dash and turn that into a chlorine. And what we're going to do now is we're going to examine the relationship between these two molecules. And what we can see is that this carbon here, even with the chlorines there, is not a chiral center, because there are two identical hydrogens here, right? So these actually are the same molecule. They're actually just different conformations of the same molecule. We could take this sigma bond here, and we could rotate it some number of degrees to have it end up looking like that other conformation. So these are the same molecule. And if we've performed this and we end up with the same molecule, then the relationship between these two protons is homotopic. They have a homotopic relationship. And so that's the definition of homotopic. Now let's go over here and let's look at enantiotopic. So what does enantiotopic mean? And so let's perform the exact same thing. Let's notice here that instead of ethane, we're actually looking at butane. So we have these two methyl groups there instead of hydrogen. And we'll do the exact same thing. We will compare these two hydrogens. And on the top one, we'll turn the one on the wedge into chlorine. On the bottom, we'll turn the one on the dash into chlorine. Now let's compare the relationship between these two molecules. And actually, in this case, we are generating a chiral center, because there are four different groups. We've got methyl, hydrogen, chlorine, and the rest of the molecule. And in fact, we are generating the opposite stereochemistry at this center, depending on which hydrogen we turn into chlorine. And so because these two molecules are enantiomers of one another, the relationship between these two protons is an enantiotopic relationship. So these are enantiomers, therefore these protons are enantiotopic. So as you can guess from the pattern here, probably, we're getting to diastereotopic. And so now with diastereotopic, let's notice the key difference here. We've actually added a hydroxyl group right there on the wedge of this carbon right here. And we're going to do yet again the exact same thing. We're going to take these two hydrogens. And for one molecule, we'll turn the one on the wedge into chlorine. And for the other one, we'll take the one on the dash and turn that into chlorine. Now, this is a different situation than for enantiotopic, because it is true that we are generating a new chiral center, and it is true that we are generating the opposite stereochemistry at that new stereocenter, depending on which one we turn into chlorine. But there is a pre-existing stereocenter. This carbon right here is also a stereocenter, and that stereochemistry is not affected. It is not altered by this activity right here. And so because this stereocenter stays the same, but we have a new stereocenter that is opposite, depending on which one we're looking at, we are actually generating two different diastereomers, right? These are not enantiomers of one another, because recall that diastereomers are molecules where one, at least one, but not all of the stereocenters are inverted. So this stereocenter is inverted, but not this one. So these are diastereomers of one another, and therefore these hydrogens have a diastereotopic relationship. And so that's these three. Let's round it off here. And the last one is heterotopic. And so heterotopic is a little bit different. And so let's say we've got this nitrobenzene And we'll arbitrarily look at these hydrogens, where we could be looking at any of them, but we'll take a look at these two. And on this one, let's take the bottom hydrogen right here and turn that into fluorine. Again, arbitrarily, could be any other element, but we're just saying we're gonna change this one into fluorine over here, and then we're gonna change this one into fluorine over here. And now we're gonna compare these two molecules. And what we see is that these are no longer mere stereoisomers of each other. These are actually structural isomers of each other. These are completely different molecules because the position of the fluorine is in a different location. And so this is actually going to make these protons, that means these protons have a heterotopic relationship. And so we've got these molecules are the same, homotopic. These molecules are enantiomers, so these were enantiotopic. These molecules are diastereomers, so these were diastereotopic. And these are structural isomers of one another, so these hydrogens are heterotopic. So hopefully that makes the definitions of these words pretty clear. Before we move on, let's just point out one other thing, because this is used often in the context of NMR spectroscopy. One thing that we want to understand about the chemical shifts of these kinds of protons is that anytime you have homotopic or enantiotopic protons, these will all have, they will all show the same chemical shift. Okay, so these protons and these protons will all show up on an NMR spectrum with exactly the same chemical shift because of the way that they're experiencing exactly the same chemical environment. On the other hand, diastereotopic and heterotopic protons will show up with a different chemical shift. So this is a very important to understand because it's going to help us interpret NMR spectra. So this is not too difficult to see because these hydrogens are actually occupying different positions on the benzene ring. So that seems relatively intuitive how these could show up with a slightly different chemical shift. For diastereotopic, it's a little bit harder to see, but just in terms of the spatial orientation of the groups, they are experiencing a slightly different chemical environment at any given time. So same chemical shift with when protons have this relationship and different chemical shift when they have one of these two relationships. So to put this into context, let's look at one example molecule and see what we can assess here. So let's say we have this interesting compound with a six-membered ring and then another three-membered ring right there. And so let's count up the hydrogens. We have 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. We have 9 protons here. What could we say about the relationships between any pair of these protons? And so obviously if we are examining protons, a pair of protons on different carbons, those would all be heterotopic because in replacing those hydrogens by some other element, we would definitely be creating different structural isomers. But for any of these carbons, for any of these pairs of protons, let's say we took these two or these two or these two or these two, if we were to examine the relationship between those pairs, we would find that all of those pairs of protons are diastereotopic. So the reason is because of this existing chiral center right there, because we have a bromine right there, anytime we try to take one of these pairs of protons and replace one of them with some other element, so let's say we put a fluorine here versus a fluorine there, we would be generating a chiral center because of the other structure on this molecule. There are other groups there, other functional groups. And so if we took put a fluorine there or a fluorine there, we would be generating two different diastereomers. And we could say the same thing for these two or these two or these two. So in this case, we can see that we have a lot of diastereotopic relationships on this molecule. And so from this example, hopefully now we have a little more confidence in being able to assign one of these relationships to any pair of protons. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.